Hi, I'm Kurt Loder. Welcome to the Year in Rock. Looking back over 1990, as we're about to do, we'll see that while there wasn't much in the way of radical new music, there was a lot of radical talk on controversial rap records in Congress and in courtrooms across the country. In fact, the big surprise hit of the year turned out to be the First Amendment to the Constitution, which guarantees all of us the right to express what's on our minds without being second-guessed by the government. 1990 was a year in which Americans, music lovers in particular, really expressed themselves, and no one more so than Madonna, who capped the year with a video for Justify My Love that was so hot that MTV declined to air it. So to kick things off, here now is the year in Madonna.
You can just thank me.
Dr. King, Malcolm X, freedom of speech is as good as sex.
Well, I'm a very sort of outspoken forward gal.
Don't talk. If you talk, I will stop speaking, all right?
Do you believe?
I'm not interested in hitting people over the head. I think that, you know, to me it's more interesting if you interject humor in all the messages. That way people get what you're saying, but they sort of get it. I mean, laughing.
Strike a pose.
A lot of people haven't seen voguing. I think it has a lot of humor to it too. I mean, it's just so sort of arrogant and there and presentational, you know what I mean? Self-conscious. And I think it's hilarious.
You shock people.
Really?
Yes, you really know how to create controversy. Mm-hmm. I saw a picture of you the other day, and one breast was hanging out.
If you've got it, flaunt it, right?
Look around, everywhere you turn is heartache. It's everywhere that you go.
In some way, she's very macho. And she's very also sensual and feminine at the same time. She's sometimes like a little girl, you know. So she has all that in herself, and I think that is very representative of herself, the macho type and the very feminine and sensual part, and sexy one.
I know how you feel. You don't know if you want to hit me or kiss me. I get a lot of that.
You can just spank me.
Have you ever been spanked, really? Yeah. Be honest.
Yeah.
Recently?
You mean the kind you get when you're a woman?
Yeah, when you were good.
Definitely.
I think that I'm offending certain groups, but I mean, I think that people who really understand what I'm doing aren't offended by it. Because it's pro-life, you know. Pro, you know, equality, it's pro humanity.
1, 2, 3, yeah!
Keep people together forever and ever.
And that's not really the mood America's in right now. It's fear of AIDS. I mean, it's just this, I mean, it's like turned everybody into these, like, 50s monsters, you know?
I believe, and I hope you do too, that we can defeat AIDS. We can do it if we do it together. Because people have the f***ing power.
Keep it together. People together forever and ever. Keep it together. People together forever and ever.
I'm not militant anything, and I think I don't want to be pedantic. I mean, there's irony in everything that I do. I just think it's better to, you know, to have humor, that's all. A sense of humor. And not take yourself too seriously.
As you saw there, Madonna was once again in the forefront of the fight against AIDS this year and against the homophobia that's become one of the sadder side effects of this awful disease.
This one's for Ryan.
She was joined by Elton John, who came to the aid of teenage AIDS victim Ryan White, and by such unlikely converts to the cause as one-time gay-slagging comic Sam Kinison.
I was just as misinformed and in awe of this plague as anybody else.
And even our former president, Ronald Reagan.
But it's the disease that's frightening.
not the people who have it.
By year's end, however, AIDS had risen four notches to number 11 on the list of leading causes of death among Americans, and the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta was predicting that more than 40,000 people would be dead of AIDS in this year alone once the final figures were tallied. Another pressing issue was the sad state of the environment, which in 1990 rallied more defenders, especially among musicians, than ever before.
Ocean sky,
ocean
future.
The Australian band Midnight Oil played on the steps of Exxon headquarters in New York City to protest last year's most spectacular environmental disaster, the Exxon Valdez oil spill.
We planted ourselves in front of Exxon because of that big black oil spill that destroyed half of Alaska. And what we're saying is, you know, let's not just be petty, let's just not be incidental, let's just not be casual about this environment thing, let's keep on caring, let's keep on holding it, let's not forget what's happened, let's make sure it doesn't happen again.
There are 5,000 people that work for the EPA in Washington, D.C. There are 5,900 people that are employed by marching bands in the military of this country. George Bush is more of the military band president than he is the environmental president. There's no doubt about it.
Environmentalism had its highest profile moment on April 22nd, which was the 20th anniversary of Earth Day. There were celebrations and concerts across the country and around the world, including a gathering of more than 500,000 people at New York's Central Park.
We can't really go down to Brazil in good conscience and tell them what to do with their rainforest when we can't even save the symbol of our own conservation movement.
Walden Pond, where Henry David Thoreau initiated the American environmental movement 150 years ago, was being crowded by real estate development. Don Henley organized a Walden benefit concert that featured a virtual Eagles reunion. May's Farm Aid 4 was the scene of much talk about chemical farming. Most farmers are financed by federally insured loans, which they can't get unless they agree to use chemical pesticides. But farmers say these same pesticides are destroying their land and their health.
There's farms all over the country where the farmers can't drink their water because of all the pesticides that's been poured onto the land.
In concert, Billy Joel has been using his hit song, The Downeaster Alexa, as a departure point for discussing water pollution.
I worry about the quality of the water. I worry about overdevelopment. I worry about pollution. I worry about what's left.
The American music industry finally began to take notice of a homegrown environmental problem, the wasteful and useless CD long box.
18.5 million pounds of garbage, which translates, if it's all from paperboard, it translates into over 157,000 trees that are destroyed just to make the things.
The musicians we talk to don't see environmental concerns as a passing fad. They say these issues are here to stay.
Mother Earth gives you so much. If you take more, eventually Mother Earth will slap you in the face. And that's what's going to happen. It's already happening.
I think rather than the public burning out on the environment may well burn out on us.
Two dance pop titans were expressing themselves in new ways this year, too, but surprisingly few people were interested in what they had to say. Prince, hot off last year's big Batman boom, bombed at stateside box offices with his self-directed feature Graffiti Bridge, even though he'd knocked him dead on a European tour earlier in the year. I don't care. George Michael, renowned for his danceable pop hits, went serious with a largely undanceable album called Listen Without Prejudice and a pair of videos in which he didn't even appear. This, he said, reflected his weariness with the superstar image he felt he'd become saddled with.
I went for that bracket that was Madonna and Prince and Jackson. And everything around Faith was engineered towards that. And I think having succeeded to a large extent, I realized that I'd kind of aimed and I'd not exactly misfired, but I ended up in the wrong room with the wrong people.
In the end, the album went platinum, but never topped the charts, and the singer canceled a serious small-scale tour he had planned in favor of a more traditional blockbuster outing in 1991. But did these two misfires mean that people had nothing to dance to in 1990? Not at all. Here's John Norris with that story.
Pump up the jam. I've got the power.
Get a life.
Okay.
kids just want to dance.
You can't keep a good thing down.
Refreshingly unexpected breakthrough of downtown New York kitsch band D-Light, fronted by the D-groovy Lady Miss Keir, was only one example of how, once again, women dominated in the world of club music. The reigning champ continued to be Madonna, and she held on to the title with one hugely successful single, which called on us all to strike a pose.
Vogue.
There was another Vogue on the charts, the girl group En Vogue, who scored a platinum single with Hold On. Other hot newcomers included D-Mob vocalist turned solo star Kathy Dennis, and perhaps the most promising of all, England's Lisa Stansfield, whose rich, soulful voice at first had people convinced she was black.
I think it's amazing how, like, all the charts have sort of picked up on the music. It's just so strange for that to happen, really, I think.
But while some were singing about dance and romance, others tried to incorporate more serious messages into their music. Soul to Soul's Jazzy B infused his second album with words about living a positive life, while Janet Jackson's Rhythm Nation brought an anti-drugs and racism and pro-education message to the masses.
I know people who are into dance music love to listen to lyrics. But it seems like most of the dance music that's been out, it hasn't been anything like this, and that's why I wanted to do something different.
The biggest wave out of Britain was The Rave, a blend of neo-psychedelic indie rock and pulsating rhythms, led by groups like the Happy Mondays, In Spiral Carpets, and the Soup Dragons.
I'm free to do what I want, any old time.
The walls between hip-hop and dance continued to fall as well, as a growing number of artists proved that it was time we all make room for some new musical labels.
Our music is mentally hip-hop, smoothed out on the R&B tip, with a pop feel appeal to it.
The search for new sounds can get you in trouble, though, as Vanilla Ice discovered with his unauthorized use of a musical line from Queen and David Bowie's Under Pressure for the number one hit, Ice Ice Baby. Unlike MC Hammer, who gave writing credit to Rick James and Prince when he used samples of their music, Ice initially contended he came up with his song all on his own.
We sampled them from him, but it's not the same bass line. Like it goes ding, 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 diggy, ding, 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 diggy, ding, ding. Ding, ding, ding. That's the way theirs goes. Ours goes ding, 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 diggy, ding, ding. Ding, 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 diggy, ding, ding. That little bitty change. It's not the same.
It basically depends upon how much of the record is used. I mean, if I take a horn from your record, don't expect a call, you know. But if I borrow some significant part of your record, then of course I feel the right to give you credit and to work out a deal with you that's going to pay you, bottom line.
Sampling vocals is, of course, another story. And one of the most widespread issues in dance this year was who's really singing.
I knew it from the start, you would break my heart.
Of course, we sing, and we proved it already, so.
The issue continued to dog Milli Vanilli throughout the year. And finally in November, their producer and arranger Frank Farian confirmed long-held suspicions that the dreadlock duo didn't sing a note on their multi-platinum debut album. This case of fraud caused Milli Vanilli to be stripped of their Grammy Award for Best New Artist.
We ended it. Robin Fab ended Milli Vanilli, not Frank Farian. We told him, if we can't sing on our record, you have to go on the press and say that we don't sing.
Out of Belgium came Technotronic, whose first hit, Pump Up the Jam, deceptively gave vocal credit to a fashion model named Felly, when it should have gone to rapper Ya Kid K.
People come up, oh, are you Felly, or where's Felly, or, you know, huh?
Musical trends, of course, tend to be cyclical, and we all remember how quickly disco fizzled out. But at the end of 1990, expressing oneself through dance shows no signs of fading.
Dance music's what it's all about, really, at the end of the day.
Maybe the funniest dance pop remark of the year came from Milli Vanilli, who, before the axe fell on their bogus career, claimed to be more talented than Elvis Presley, Paul McCartney, and Bob Dylan. We've got some other memorable quotes for you right now, and we will be back with a very lively look at the year in concert, so don't go away.
The only reason we've done what we've done is because this is what we do.
People, they talk like this.
And you think he's singing, and you don't like this. And you think the poster, I love you, and you don't like this.
Duh. Shut up, we're doing an interview.
That's a stupid-ass question.
Oh, chill out.
The left side is not quite as ripe. It's like a good cheese.
I like girls with mustaches, though.
Boy!
Kill the politicians, that'll be a start.
You know, it's lonely at the top, but it's a lot lonelier at the bottom.
You guys know you're great singers.
Gina, you have lipstick on your tooth.
Fix it.
Okay.
Well, some of the songs will remain the same.
Turn the camera off, we eating in here.
No, go ahead, have some of that chicken right there.
I know that's right.
Wow.
Welcome back to the Year in Rock 1990. In a year filled with free expression, most musicians continue to express themselves most freely, of course, on stage. So here now is a quick look at the year in concert.
One, two, three,
four. On the road.
Joel and just about every other performer who took the stage, looking out at all those screaming fans still makes them, well, nervous.
Probably be nervous right before I go on. I'll get dry mouth. You know?
I always think I'm going to forget everything. I always get that nightmare that I go on stage and I haven't learnt a word and I'm just stuck out there and all this music's playing and I've got no ideas. What did I write? I can't remember a word of it.
You got your mother.
There was an unusually large number of acts competing for concert dollars this year, and many bands that may have expected sold-out shows didn't get them. But fans did turn out in droves for the acts they love.
They're the best. There's no one that's better than Depeche Mode.
We shall touch me.
Concern instead with burn. We're hell's our concern. Pain and skepticism of pimp. I refuse to be a hoe. Who stole the soul? Soul!
Yeah. Come on!
Soul!
Motley Crue brought its Dr. Feelgood show to arenas across the country.
I just go out and just kick the most amount of ass I can kick on my drums and as a band, as a whole, and then we split.
Billy Idol crawled back onto the boards to tour the U.S. and Europe after recovering from a near-fatal motorcycle accident.
I was in a lot of pain for the first 2 weeks, but that's virtually over now, so there's nothing stopping me now.
Paul McCartney mixed new material with vintage oldies, as did the Rolling Stones, who wound up their world tour in Europe. And in smaller venues, bands like Midnight Oil continued the trend of mixing social causes with their music.
People are going to rock out of here, and that's fine. But if some of them rock out with their minds turning and the next day do something different, then that's even better.
Social causes also combine with music at a number of benefit concerts. Roger Waters mounted an all-star production of The Wall to help create a European disaster relief fund. Bruce Springsteen joined Jackson Brown and Bonnie Raitt for his first concert appearance in 2 years to raise money for the Christic Institute's legal battle with the U.S. government. And Nebworth, England was the site of an all-star benefit featuring the rest of Pink Floyd, as well as Elton John, Eric Clapton, and Robert Plant with his ex-Zeppelin mate Jimmy Page, all of whom played for the Nordoff Robbins Music Therapy Foundation.
Helps them through the music to communicate with the outside world, and it really, you know, it's a wonderful thing to be able to do.
Aerosmith continued its pump tour into 1990, even playing a party at New York's Hard Rock Cafe during what was supposed to be a 2-week break. Attendees were treated to a 45-minute blues jam. Jamming, however, was the last thing on the minds of an increasing number of acts who lip-synced their shows or employed pre-recorded backup tracks in 1990. Some observers see this trend as a fraud, but others figure it's just giving the 90s audience what it wants.
If you entertain the crowd, that's what they came to see.
We can't deny the importance of choreography and visuals in the last 10 years. Kids find it equally important as music. That maybe is a little bit sad, but that's the fact.
Live, or whatever, in 1990. This year marked the beginning of a new decade, of course, but it was also, in some ways, a year of looking back. In January, The Who, The Kinks, and Simon and Garfunkel were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. In June, the legendary Velvet Underground reunited for one song at an Andy Warhol tribute outside of Paris. And in September, the 20th anniversary of the death of Jimi Hendrix was observed with the release of new books, records, and rare archival footage of the great guitarist in action. Another posthumous milestone was the 50th birthday of the late John Lennon, which was celebrated in October with a worldwide broadcast of his song, Imagine. However, a memorial concert in Liverpool last May, arranged by Lennon's widow, Yoko Ono, was sparsely attended and drew an unflattering review from Lennon's old partner, Paul McCartney.
My feeling about it was that John wouldn't have enjoyed it. But I think there were one or two on that bill that he might have thrown up over.
The Beatles did finally resolve the long-running lawsuits among themselves this year, and a number of other stars spent time in court, too. Here's a quick look at some of them, and we'll be right back with the year in rap and metal, so do stay with us.
I'm picking up good vibrations. This morning in Santa Monica Superior Court, I filed a petition to establish a conservatorship of Brian Wilson, my cousin and founder of the Beach Boys. I have taken this action out of deep concern for the health and welfare of my cousin.
I have not seen or heard from Stan Love for over 4 years. I cannot imagine why he would do this.
Hi, we're Living Color.
The band. Stereotype.
Welcome back to the Year in Rock. No one had waited longer for the right to speak his mind this year than South African political leader Nelson Mandela. After nearly three decades in a white prison, Mandela was finally free to tour the world and to take in a celebratory concert in his honor at Wembley Stadium outside of London. Mandela was an especially big hero in the rap community, of course, and if 1990 could be said to be the year of any particular style of music, rap, which was suddenly all over the pop charts, was definitely it. And one of the hardest hitting acts, once again, was Public Enemy.
Dead or alive.
You're not gonna get more hipper than rap. I don't care what you do.
Drop it!
I fell into a Sly Stone Jimi Hendrix thing, and I wanted to see rap go to a point where it hadn't gone before, because I felt that I had to take rap to another plane. We're trendsetters, we're not followers.
So-called gangster rap, with its vivid depictions of street violence, misogyny, and drug use, went gold and platinum in 1990. Critics deplored the violence, but rappers defended their freedom of expression.
We're like, you know, news reporters. We're telling exactly what's going on the streets.
Some people look at me and they hate me just for the message I put out, what I portray, you know what I mean? But other kids love me.
The Ghetto Boys gangster rap record was so graphically violent that its distributor, Geffen Records, refused to carry it and stopped doing business with the group's label, Def American.
Now when it's live, the jungle in day like so, or at the club, I'll bring you up for
the grab. The Afrocentric school of rap also flourished this year, especially a group of rappers known as the Native Tongues.
We want the world to unite, so we set an example by showing that we have a family structure within the Native Tongues. There can be a family structure within the planet Earth.
Act yourself with someone else and make sure yourself ain't by yourself.
Cause I'm a product, of the environment.
There were all sorts of intriguing rap hybrids this year. The white street rap of Third Base.
With Cycle Funk.
A Samoan rap band called the Booyah Tribe. And of course, rap comedy.
I tried to make rap records, but no matter what I did, everybody thought it was funny.
1990 also brought the first Saturday morning rap TV show, a hit rap movie, and a rap star's primetime network comedy series.
Yo, what's up, Jay?
In addition, this year, female rappers such as Moni Love, Salt-N-Pepa, Queen Latifah, MC Light, Nikki D, and Yo-Yo took up the fight against the often sexist lyrics of their male counterparts.
We've taken steps towards bonding as women, you know, to be strong and unite as women, you know.
Pass the old gold! I'm gonna knock you out!
Veteran rappers such as LL Cool J, Eric B. and Rakim, and Boogie Down Productions released successful albums this year. And after a prolonged absence, rap's first major stars, Run-DMC, also returned.
First we raised hell, before that we were the kings of rock, you know what I'm saying? Then we became Run-DMC, so now we're back from hell.
Gang violence needs to be wiped out.
Finally, there was the hip-hop event of the year, a massive gathering of California rappers, known as the West Coast Rap All-Stars, who united to help stop gang violence with their music. The project was called We're All in the Same Gang.
I felt that most of the youth today respect the rappers. I knew most of the best rappers in the world, so I asked them when we come together and try to do a little song, hoping that the proceeds would go to help the youth today.
We should at least be at peace with ourselves before we can be at peace with everybody else.
Rap music, with its big beat and outspoken attitudes, drew more and more non-black fans this year. Among them, as it turned out, Guns N' Roses frontman Axl Rose, who told us he loves Public Enemy. Although the Guns themselves were unable to complete a new album this year, Rose was very much in the news anyway. First of all, Rose got married to rock legend Don Everly's daughter. Then he got arrested after a run-in with his next-door neighbor. And he went public with his reason for the dismissal of Guns N' Roses drummer Steven Adler.
We had Steven sign a contract saying if he went back to drugs, then he was out. Couldn't leave his drugs.
Guns N' Roses did make one appearance this year at Farm Aid 4, where they unveiled a hot new song called Civil War. If Guns N' Roses maintained a relatively low profile, an army of other hard rock and metal acts was everywhere in evidence, as you're about to see. The biggest surprise hit of 1990 was provided by the long-running Australian band AC/DC, whose 14th album, The Razor's Edge, literally rocketed to the top of the charts. What was the secret of this unexpected success?
We've always remained the same. I don't think we've ever really looked for outside influence. I don't know why. Maybe we should.
Influences abounded elsewhere on the metal scene, though. A wave of neo-psychedelic grunge from Seattle, an ongoing funk metal fusion in the San Francisco Bay Area, futuristic speed crunch from the Northeast, and even some turbocharged Beatlesisms. If metal was unusually big this year, it was also a big target. At one point, New York's publicity-loving John Cardinal O'Connor claimed that metal acts such as Ozzy Osbourne actually promoted Satanism.
I'm not a Satanist. I don't worship the devil. And it takes me all my time to conjure myself out of bed in the morning, let alone to conjure the devil up.
As big as hard rock music was in 1990, though, the general run of hard rock lyrics had little that was new to say. Unskinny Bop, the Poison hit, was typical.
Came from a situation with CeCe. I walked in on him and these two girls having a rather interesting early rehearsal, and but that's what the song and the rest of it I leave for the imagination.
Equally mired in the same old sexual fantasies was Warrant. One hard rocker, ex-David Lee Roth sideman Steve Vai, sidestepped this predicament by scoring an instrumental hit. Others came up with something substantial to talk about, like Queensryche, whose top 10 album Empire dealt with some of the hard choices facing young people in a society built upon instant gratification.
Everyone wants things now. It's very hard to be patient and wait, you know, because everything, all the information now comes at you so quickly.
In general, the harder rock was this year, the bigger an audience it found. A case in point was Megadeth, which scored with a blistering LP called Rust in Peace. This band's secret?
You know, when I write music, I think about, like, sex, you know, and violence. Mm. It's kind of Clockwork Orange, but, you know, it works.
So metal was stronger than ever this year, a fact that was celebrated at the 10th annual Monsters of Rock Festival at Castle Donington in England, a show that covered everything from the music's roots to its future, which seems pretty much guaranteed by the undying loyalty of its fans. Inevitably, American music once again suffered some sad losses this year. Soul giant Curtis Mayfield was sidelined with a broken spine after a freak stage accident in New York this summer. And in August, a post-concert helicopter crash snuffed out the life of the fiery Texas guitarist Stevie Ray Vaughan. We're going to say a final farewell to some other departed musicians. And when we come back, we'll take a look at the year in Bon Jovi and the three big new stars of 1990. So do stay tuned. To the year in rock. As we noted at the top of the show, while 1990 was a big year for freedom of expression, there wasn't a whole lot in the way of startling new music. There was the usual complement of new acts, though, and for them, getting attention by whatever means was mainly the name of the game.
You listen, do me, baby.
Do what you like.
Vision of law.
Humpty Hump.
What you have to have is something that stands out.
Thanks. Thank you very, very much. I really appreciate it.
Singer-songwriter Michael Penn happened to be the brother of actor Sean Penn, and he wasn't the only member of the class of 90 to have a well-known relative.
Here she comes.
The Nelson twins were the sons of 50s teen idol Ricky Nelson, and Wilson Phillips was a combination of China Phillips, whose parents are Michelle and John Phillips of the 60s pop group The Mamas and the Papas, and Carney and Wendy Wilson, whose father is Beach Boy Brian Wilson.
I love the harmonies in the Beach Boys, and we inherited the love of harmony, you know? That's what our group is about, that's our sound.
Devo. Belle Biv DeVoe also had a pedigree. They're all members of the teen group New Edition, although they left their old image behind to strike out on their own.
New Edition was more of a clean-cut group, you know. We wouldn't be seen, you know, kissing or touching a girl's body and things like that.
Hey, Calloway, come on, don't forget.
This time around, the BBD image is so outrageous. We're just getting into everything.
Faith No More is another band with a history of its own, too. They've been around for 8 years before a revamped lineup finally struck platinum with an album called The Real Thing. Faith No More's metal-funk sound was nicely complemented by the band's antics, both on stage and off.
All work and no play makes Jack a dull boy.
That's nice. We appreciate all the support.
We love it. We
thanks,
dig
guys.
It.
Can I borrow $20?
Also big this year were singer Mariah Carey, who soared up the pop charts on the crest of a mighty promotional push, Slaughter, a band that hit big with a pop metal sound, and on the rap scene, a very novel act called Digital Underground.
Do what you like.
You got rock, you got rap, you got rhythm and blues. Then you have super, stupid, triple dope, cold, ignorant, underground, hip-hop, Humpty Funk.
Yeah.
And right now, we're the only group in that category. So I guess, you know, we had nothing to do but rise to the top.
I do the Humpty Hump. Come on, I do the Humpty Hump. Check me out, y'all. I do the Humpty Hump. Just watch me do the Humpty Hump.
1990 was filled with of new pop sounds and sometimes borrowed old ones. But the Black Crowes proved that old-fashioned rock and roll still had a place in the charts, too.
I thought it'd be this uphill battle, us trying to kick rock and roll again. And so far, people have, like, opened the door, and it's been like, we're expecting the fight, and we walk in, and people are handing us, you know, deli trays and stuff, so it's great.
There was a new solo act topping the charts this year, too. It was John Bon Jovi. The veteran frontman put Bon Jovi the band on hold to take a bit part in the post-Brat Pack Western Young Guns 2, and then struck gold with his solo semi-soundtrack album for the film and its resounding hit single.
I think that anyone who puts out a record at the end of the day, no matter who he is or how big his band is, wants people to like him. So, you know, I'd like to be liked, too. You don't make a record so that people can go, you suck, and you go, that's great.
Another veteran who broke big this year was Bonnie Raitt, who made a surprise sweep of the Grammys with her album Nick of Time. The other big breakouts of 1990 were A Tough Irish Skinhead, A Friendly West Coast Rapper, and A Pint-Sized Cartoon with Attitude. Here's John Norris.
Hammer time.
Eat my short.
Can't touch this.
And the winner for the best video of the year is... Sinead O'Connor.
In 1987, the critics fell for a fiery Irish newcomer called Sinead O'Connor. But in 1990, it was the masses' turn to discover her once they got a glimpse of her softer side with a love song straight out of Prince's musical closet. Outspoken as ever, in May, Sinead pulled out of an appearance on Saturday Night Live, hosted by comedian Andrew Dice Clay.
I thought that it would be irresponsible of me to endorse it by appearing with him, because if some young boy, for example, is watching me on the television and thinks I'm great, like, and is in any way influenced by me, then he'll probably think that it's fine to go around, you know, slagging off women and everything else.
Then in August, Frank Sinatra wanted to, quote, kick her ass after she refused to allow the national anthem to be played before a concert in New Jersey.
I don't see what national anthems have to do with music. And secondly, as I spoke to you before about this, that I feel very strongly about censorship, and I didn't want to go on stage after the national anthem of a country that's imposing censorship on friends of mine, you know.
October found her in Chile for an Amnesty International concert. And while comic Sam Kinison sported a skinhead and poked fun at her, Sinead herself donned a platinum wig and turned in a modern version of a Cole Porter tune for the AIDS charity album Red Hot and Blue.
Stop!
have a time.
But if Sinead O'Connor found success in spite of herself, there was nothing accidental about the breakthrough of MC Hammer. His second album, Please Hammer, Don't Hurt Him, had commercial written all over it. And yet almost no one expected it to be the biggest record of the year. But even if he did strike a chord with the public, fellow rappers still felt compelled to put the hammer down.
If your record crosses over pop and you get white listeners, Latin listeners, and listeners who are not black, you are called a sellout. If that's a sellout, then here I am. I'm a sellout because I want my music to be accepted by all people.
Hammer also managed to sell himself to corporate America by signing deals with British Knights Footwear and Pepsi Cola. MC Hammer's interracial appeal matched that of the true pop icon of 1990, Bart Simpson. Bart Mania was fueled by the runaway success of The Simpsons, the series created by cult cartoonist Matt Groening, which mounted a serious challenge to Bill Cosby's domination of prime time.
I'll grow up.
As Bart fired off one-liners and got into one adventure after another on the small screen, out in the real world, the Bart craze only got bigger, despite some schools across the country which banned Bart's underachiever and proud of it t-shirts.
A Simpson on a t-shirt? I never thought I'd see the day.
And as the year drew to a close, Bart's status as a TV star was confirmed. Following such past television hunks turned singers as Don Johnson, Bruce Willis, and Rick Springfield.
What a nightmarish concept.
Bart!
The Radical Dude released his own debut single, Do the Bart Man, from the new album, The Simpsons Sing the Blues.
So move your body if you got the notion. Front to back in a rock-like motion. Now that you got it if you think you can. Feed it through the music, that's the Bart Man. And the beat goes on.
The number one story of 1990, of course, was censorship. And after a quick look at some of the year's most memorable video images, we'll be surveying that situation too, so don't go away.
Yo, bump up the jam, bump it up, bump it up. Yo, bump it, bump up the jam, bump it up, bump it up. Yo, bump it, bump up the jam, bump it up, bump it up. Yo, bump it, bump up the jam, bump it, bump it, bump it, bump it.
Welcome back to the Year in Rock. 1990 was a year in which freedom spread like a long smoldering brush fire across Eastern Europe. Back here at home, though, one of our most important freedoms, the freedom of speech, was under attack by both conservatives and liberals. And musicians got hit by much of the flack.
Two live crew. Self-limited messages. Parental advisory.
If it's going to happen to records, well, won't it happen to everything else?
I mean, who decides what's obscene?
If you don't like it, don't buy.
Obscenity, if you put a label on it, is still obscenity.
The First Amendment to the Constitution is very clear about freedom of speech. And yet somebody, somewhere, is always trying to carve out an exception to outlaw words or images or actions that they don't like. The most blatant attempt at outright censorship this year was directed at the Miami rap group 2 Live Crew and their admittedly X-rated raunch album, As Nasty As They Wanna Be. Is this stuff stupid? Well, yes.
I think the brothers are kind of ignorant.
But is it actually bad for you? Bad enough to be banned?
We talk the same thing as Dice Clay talks. We talk the same thing that Murphy talked. You know, it's just hooked up to a rap beat.
No one has ever produced as sexually explicit an album in the history of the world, and no one, in my opinion, has ever produced an obscene record album ever, except for this one album by one rap group out of my hometown, Miami, Florida, and that's why I've gone after them.
Jack Thompson, a born-again Florida lawyer and moral crusader, mounted a faxing campaign to police and prosecutors urging a crackdown on 2 Live Crew. The immediate effect of this was to help 2 Live Crew sell lots and lots of dirty records.
They walked out of that small town in Florida and went,
thank you, Jesus.
This controversy has elevated to them to this huge, huge status, and the bottom line is they're probably one of the weakest rap bands ever in the history of rap music.
Then in June, a local federal judge ruled that the 2 Live Crew album was obscene. 2 days later, record store owner Charles Freeman was arrested for selling it, and 2 days after that, the group itself was busted for performing songs from it at an adults-only nightclub. Suddenly, the censors seemed to be winning.
We got them. We got them real good.
Who would ever think that here in the United States of America, we will be telling grown people what they can purchase and what they can't purchase?
When the obscenity case against 2 Live Crew finally came to court, though, a mostly white jury laughed it right back out again.
We, the jury, find as follows. As to the defendant, Luther Campbell, the defendant is not guilty.
That wasn't the end of the new censorship hysteria, though. Jesse Helms led a charge against the National Endowment for the Arts for its support of sexually explicit art. A couple of local authorities tried to crack down on a Jane's Addiction album cover, but were quickly beaten back. And liberals even got into the act, instituting restrictions against racially and sexually sensitive speech on college campuses. And, of course, a pair of Midwestern evangelists called the Peters Brothers were still on the job, burning what seemed like every rock record they could lay their hands on.
Uriah Heep, this is their album entitled Demons and Wizards. We'll be burning that tonight.
Parental guidance, explicit lyrics.
At its peak, the anti-rock frenzy created a clamor in at least 20 states for record stickering laws, but these proposals withered away when the music industry obligingly agreed to start stickering records on its own, a concept that not all musicians found objectionable.
I don't see anything wrong with putting a sticker on there that says this record contains extremely profane lyrics. I don't think that that is a crime.
The most surreal proceeding of the year was certainly the subliminal messages trial of the English metal band Judas Priest. The charge, burying the mysterious phrase "do it" in the mix of an album and thereby driving two very troubled high school dropouts to suicide.
I think the real obscenity is that these two kids' deaths are being used to raise a lot of cash.
In the end, common sense and Judas Priest prevailed.
We knew the verdict couldn't be anything else. I mean, there are no subliminal messages on the album. The whole thing was farcical. I mean, it should never have got to court.
All of these setbacks for censors served to embolden civil libertarians and to help fuel a music industry-sponsored registration campaign called Rock the Vote.
If you vote, at least you can't complain because you've done your part in it.
We all have certain beliefs and we think, oh, it's censorship is crazy, everyone's against it, but unfortunately not everyone is against it, and those of us who are, a lot of us aren't out there voting, and so this is the issue of the day.
Obviously, although a few battles were won this year, the issue of censorship was still very much alive.
Who knows? It might be George Michaels. He might not be saying, I want your sex next year. You know what I'm saying? And then Guns N' Roses, and you know, people who sell a lot of records. Next thing you know, Madonna, she had to put her clothes on, her share, you know? Before you know it, the music industry will be no more.
No more censorship!
In the end, though, even the hardest rockers agreed that self-appointed censors and other freelance prudes do sometimes serve a purpose.
Thank you, Tipper and Jesse, for making sure that as long as there are a few four-letter words in the album, it will always sell an extra million copies.
So that was 1990, a year in which rock and pop musicians were at the forefront of a new fight against censorship and cultural repression. Will they now be able to get back to the business of making some new music in the months ahead? I guess we'll be able to tell next year at this time. We'll see you then.
Faith and 2 Live is what we are.
Suited out, popping with.